now we have the session about the international organizations. We have 5 of them here, and the plan is till 4 o'clock to have 5 minutes for each of them. I will give them a question, and I hope they will answer it. And then we have the plenary debate, and I hope we have enough time to do the to have that then till 4 o'clock. So they all who are sitting here were so nice to prepare the fact sheets, so they don't have to tell you what they do in their international organizations, because you already find it in your booklet. But we can focus on the future and future challenges. And that's why I want to begin with my first question to Hans van Delden from the Council for International Organizations of Medical Sciences, CIOMS. And you see in the fact sheets that there have a working group on the revision of the CIOMS ethical guidelines for biomedical research. And I think this is a subject that is interesting for us, not now learning in detail what they're doing there, but what I would be interested in is what are the main challenges or what are the main changes in research that brings you to revise the guidelines, and what will all of us have to think about in the future when we want to do responsible research?
But first of all, let me also join you in thanking Manuel and the organizer of this conference for being here and allowing CIOMS to participate, which is great. But I very much agree with you that what these guidelines and the revised guidelines should look like is not a document that really captures the past, but actually that serves the future. So we are trying to write something that will be helpful for the next 10 years. And of course, the danger is that we write something that nicely captures what we have come to see in the past 10 years instead of is apt for the coming 10 years. And I think what I think is happening is that we are trying to strike a new balance between protecting individual interests and, let's say, the interests of society. Actually, I was going to quote a phrase that Christine Grady gave this morning. She said, I think we have come to the realization that we do not only want to protect people from research, but actually also through research, that research can be a means to protect people, because if we do research, we will get knowledge, and that knowledge might actually be a way to serve their interests. And if we acknowledge that, then we indeed do have to have another picture of research, but also another picture of the guidelines. We have to have a new balance in which, again, individual interests and societal interests are well balanced. And one issue in that respect is whether or not you want research to have social value. And so for us, in the CIOMS guidelines, we actually intend to have a guideline on social value, and we think that it's a pity that the DOH did not have that, the Declaration of Helsinki. They have, of course, risk-benefit balances, but there is not really a prerequisite condition that the research should always have social value. And in CIOMS, we thought that this really should be the case. So we will have a guideline on social value, and that means that committees in reviewing a research protocol will have to be convinced by the researcher, obviously, that indeed there is a potential for future benefit for society in this particular protocol. And that I can see all kinds of challenges here, but that is one of the ways that we are trying to make this future-proof, if I may say that. There are other issues which actually have also been talked about this morning, such as how to, I mean, acknowledging vulnerability on the one hand, and on the other hand, involving people who are vulnerable in certain respects in research at the same time. What I really, really like in the CIOMS discussions is that we try to be as specific as possible about why we do certain things. So it's not just a decree like we want you to do this or to do that, but to really think about why do we need to put this provision here, and do we need this instrument here? Quoting Christine Grady again this morning, she said, well, if we do involve children in risky research, then when is that okay? And is risk limitations the only instrument we have in sort of protecting their interests? And my answer, and probably hers as well, would be no, there are other instruments as well. And so we can really also have a discussion about which instruments to use to protect, on the one hand, let's say the vulnerable side of these people, but on the other hand, also their interests in being part of research, which I think they should be. Should, as in, there should be an opportunity to have them in being involved in research. Yeah, I'll leave it at that for the moment.
Thank you very much. Now I come to Laurence Loeff from the Council of Europe, and you find the activities in the field of bioethics also summarized in your booklet. And when I studied them, I came to a question I think that we are all thinking about a lot, that the border or the line between things you can solve or think about at least on the level of principles and universal rights and things where we should all agree upon, and those where we say there are differences in moral habits, attitudes, and so on that are justified on a cultural level. Yeah, we're on a global summit. So many cultures are coming together. We don't want to melt them. We want to preserve them. But there are things where we should really have a consensus on protection of human subjects and so on. And when I studied these issues, I asked myself, how does the Council of Europe deal with this line between universal rights or universalized laws, legal rules, principles, and cultural differences? Can you comment on that, please?
The Council of Europe is a regional organization compared to the geographical scope of this event. And I think that was important when you mentioned principles. I mean, there are some core values which are the basis for developing principles. And I, well, dare to say that those developed at the Council of Europe, even though being original organizations, have been recognized of having universal value by, for example, the reference to the Oviedo Convention in the Declaration of UNESCO. And so we are core value, we have principles. I would say where it becomes possibly a little bit more difficult is when you start developing provisions in a legal instrument based on the principles. Both because the devil is in the details, so to say, and also because that even though agreement in principle can be reached, there might be situations when you have tensions between principles, and the hierarchy of those principles may vary. And this can obviously be the case at global level, but also at European level or regional level. So, I think that in the list of documents that are presented in this fact sheet, you have different nature of instrument, and the content is also different. When you are talking about a legally binding instrument, you would define the provision in a way which is quite simple, giving the fundamental principle. And the way it will be implemented will be developed possibly in the explanatory report as examples, but then the margin of maneuver will be to the state will be considered to be greater. That doesn't mean that it's completely opened. And this is part of the discussions in agreeing in the principle. The explanatory report intends to describe the intention of the drafters, so it kind of set the limits of the margin of maneuver for that. Now, when you go on something like the decision-making process, the guide on end of life, which is a very sensitive issue, and it is true, I think, for all countries and whatever level you take. I think this is not a legal instrument. It goes much more into the detail. So it can go further in referring to the different positions, the different attitudes, the different roles of the people involved. And you can develop on that while considering that all these elements are not jeopardizing the principle that is behind it. So the way it's developed in each instrument, depending on the nature of this instrument, but we also have to acknowledge that on certain issue, it's not possible to get agreement, even at the level of principle. And I think this is the case on certain end-of-life issues and on certain beginning-of-life issues, which are probably the most difficult areas. But it's not solved even at regional level. But the nature of the discussion, I think that's what is important also, is that it's not only the end result of standard setting activity that is meaningful, it's the whole process, because the process of developing a legal instruments mean you have exchange, you have consultations, including a national level, and you have a more, would say, development of a discourse with a better understanding of what are the elements at stake behind, and more possibility to reach consensus. And I wouldn't say minimum consensus, but consensus on what are the necessary principles to protect the value on which we agreed.
I think that was very elaborated for this time, and gave us some points to start to discuss further. Not necessarily now, because I have to switch, but hopefully in the plenary debate. And I'm very grateful that you said that ethical deliberation is not necessarily finding the minimum, yeah, because morals mean more than finding the minimum. Yeah. So I turn to Jim Dratva from the European Commission. And when I studied his fact sheet, I learned that we not only have research ethics committees and ethics and bioethics committees dealing with something else than research, but bioethics, but that they broaden the scope to energy, security, surveillance technologies. So that seems, for me, to be a completely different realm of topics. So how to deal with this, and how to guarantee that we in our national ethics councils have the experts to deal with all these topics? Okay. Jim, it's your floor.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Christiane. And really, I want to express my deep appreciation to Manuel and his team, indeed to our WHO colleagues. This is a remarkable conference, and it gives me great pleasure that we'd be able to reflect together on those important issues, which really touch, especially the question that you raised just now, on the role that we see for ethics committees, for ethics councils. It dovetails in a way with the discussion we had yesterday, highlighting the differences between our different national committees. And also looking at the particular path dependency, the particular history which led different ethics committees to do the work that they do. More fundamentally, it touches on the question of the role of ethics councils, the role of the work that we do, or all of us in our different ways. So very specifically, it is indeed the case that at the level of the European Commission, whereas if you look in the early 90s, the inception of the different structures we have in place were very much centered on biotechnology and on the biomedical, so really the core bioethical issues, end of life, beginning of life, but with also a particular take already at that time on biotechnology. There's been a remarkable evolution which is an evolution that is marked importantly by the EU Charter, the Charter of Fundamental Rights, an evolution bringing this ethical reflexivity to all areas of public policy, to all the key issues of our time. So indeed, energy choices, very important, information, communication technologies, and this very exciting project that we've just completed a few weeks back on the ethics of security and surveillance technologies. Think of Edward Snowden, think of what happened to you on your way here as you were passing through the security checks at the airport. And more broadly, the exactly, something we can all relate to. And more broadly, really the question of what world is it we want to live in? The next opinion that the European Group on Ethics will be tackling, the next set of issues, are to do with, within the realm of health and health technologies, this key interrogation on the different modalities of involvement of the public, of the wider public, in the production of knowledge and innovation, and also in the production of this ethical reflexivity. Now, this is just to give you the crucial broader picture about the world in which you live and also about our own role as all of us sitting around this table, thinking about the meaning of our job, the meaning of our lives, and what does ethics come and do in all this. Now, very concretely, on the issue of expertise within the within our respective organizations or committees or councils, I think one of the learnings that we've acquired as different organizations and also as a community of friends and colleagues is the fact that we don't know it all. And so this is very much taken at heart in the way we organize our work, which is about involving as many stakeholders, as many different voices, different forms of expertise, although of course this concept itself has to be reflected upon, as many different voices to broaden the ethical reflexivity debate, our horizons in terms of ethical deliberations, and so not relying on expertise that we would have in-house on every possible topic, but relying on the notion that we can't know it all and that we have to take these different voices from outside as well.
Thank you so much. So that's about encouraging us to broaden the scope and to just pick up the most pressing subjects in the country and just to invite the experts you need for them. Yep. Then that's a question of networking as well, and so I come to the WHO and Ava, who has a lot of experience in that now in preparing or being the permanent secretariat for the Global Summit and to put all the email lists together and to identify the partners. And in your fact sheet, you also describe that you try to bring the next together on a regional level and so on, what UNESCO does as well. But we saw in the steering committee that the networking is a tricky thing. And for the next session, what will be chaired by you, I think it's a good beginning to start with thinking about what are the main challenges of bringing NECs and bioethical institutions together so that they share their information, that resources can be pooled, that the relationship between NECs and international organizations can be organized in a way that everyone knows from each other and that not two organizations have to do the same thing twice.
Networking is always a challenging task. It's not something we are taught in our formative years, or it's not a course that people do. So you learn to do the networking on the job, so to say. What I found most challenging was this, while convening for the Global Summit, it was more challenging partly because of the different natures of ethics committees across the world. Different countries have established different mechanisms for the national ethics committees. They're not the same. In some countries, they're bioethics committees. Some countries, they're commissions. Some countries, they're research ethics committees. And they all do similar functions, but still, they're slightly different. They're under different ministries. They're under different umbrellas. So it's obviously then, and we work in the area of health. So we are, WHO is focused much more on public health and health-related issues. So it is, by working with other organizations that, for example, with UNESCO, so you work together with UNESCO to see what sort of institutions they are looking after so that we can get together. We work then with talking to different colleagues in the same country as well. So you have one neck and then you say, okay, where do you find other informations? And in the end, to see how they can have a common issues that they can talk about on the table. And I think we find a middle ground because some NECs may be focused more on research, but still they're talking about ethical issues. Research still involves human beings. We're still talking about risks and benefits to different groups of people. And they can still talk on the same table with other NECs who are perhaps looking at more societal level issues or who are looking more at, let's say, even energy-related issues, but human beings are involved all the time. So I think we can still be on the same table and then talk of the same issues in different contexts, and that's okay. And they learn from each other, so maybe the expectation, my hope is that if there's a National Ethics Committee sitting here which is focusing on one area, and then they say, oh, but that another ethics committee is also looking at something else, let me go back and see how I can do it. That is an achievement. That is something we say, yes, this is a successful summit. So I think it's challenging, but it's also very rewarding. So we try, and I think we have been quite successful, and I hope to increase our success even more. Now knowing, you know, you start with 10 people, and then from 10 you can go on to 20, and then so we have, I think, more than 50 next year, perhaps. So that's a success.
Thank you very much. But I think what we should think about as well is not only that the necks that are present here bring some information back to their necks, but that we make something out of this global summit. Yeah, to just to be here is not only exchanging, but we should really be aware of thinking, what can we contribute as a global summit, yeah, to be here together. Yeah? I think that might be a task for the next steering committee as well, but it can be discussed perhaps in the next session as well. So I will come to Daphna Feinholz and back to the issues. When the World Health Organization is mainly dealing with health issues, the UNESCO's scope is also broader. And what do you feel, what do you think? You have your organizational complications at the moment with all the committees and restructuring, we all know that. But what do you think are the main challenges from the point of view of the issues that we have to deal with, and where do you think the Global Summit can contribute something?
Thank you. The restructuring in UNESCO, well, administratively it can be very burdensome, but I think thematically it's going to be very interesting, because we got now together bioethics and ethics of science and technology. So this already UNESCO was very well positioned in order to address the bioethical issues, because we have all the science, the natural sciences, the human and social sciences, the science and technology, we have the communication, we have education, so that's why it's like very natural for discussing bioethics in a very wide way, which is always related to health, but it doesn't have to stay with health, and that's why it can cover national bioethics committees in this wider scope of action, and that's why we try to work with this type of national bioethics committees to bring them together also when they are in the work that they are doing regionally and also internationally. And as I was saying yesterday, we are also trying to bring them into I mean just trying to add to something that was commented also before. How can we bring also the national bioethics committees to the international dialogue, which is also to answer your question about the main challenges? I think this natural mandate of UNESCO has also been translated in having the two unique global forum for discussion on principles and to define frameworks. I think Laurence described very well the process and the importance of the process of identifying them and putting them together. And what's the, and so in UNESCO, you also take into account also these the differences in culture, in education, in religion, and so forth. And that's why we have been able to establish three normative documents, right, to give the framework for bioethics. And now we are going also to have been working together with the Commission for the World Commission for Ethics and for Science and Technology. We have identified, and I think that the national committees at the Global Forum can address some of, at least from our side, we have identified basically important gaps between legislations, because, for example, in UNESCO, okay, we have already also have, as Laurent said, there are principles, then you have to have some other guidance to implement them. And that's why we have also the reports that are being produced by some committees, and then we have the capacity building, which are based on the documents we have. So we work together with the committees now. There are lots of gaps. We were speaking about gaps in the first session, and some of the gaps are between the legislation and the frameworks and the possibility to implement the legislations. There are gaps in education. There are gaps between the possibilities in countries with the national committees. There are lots of gaps, and particularly I think we are going to focus, and the three committees are going to work on that, which is the lack of access. I think the motto will be now so global justice. That will be like the umbrella for the committees to work. So to identify which kind of, so that's, for example, why the IBC is going to work now on benefit sharing. The potential work to be done together between the two committees will be probably, for example, ethical issues of converging technologies. So then you can have the scope of more related health issues by the IBC and all those who are without the realm of health by the other committee. And since this is a way of bringing them together, and of course with taking into account and collaboration with the Council of Europe. So, and I think one of the, it will be important for the, if the Global Summit is addressing some of these on justice in the access of both at the national level of capacities to create knowledge, to the results of knowledge, to the benefits of science and technology, for example, could be good. And one, as I was, just to finalize in my last 1 minute, as I explained in my first intervention and in the first day, we are also planning to bring together the national commissions now we are planning for the medium term to have meetings together with the IBC, IGBC, and COMEST, because we want to really foster the dialogue between the three committees. And the idea is to build into this one-week meeting, for example, modules to bring national bioethics committees. In that way, the issues that the national bioethics committees are discussing on the front line can be brought to the global forum, let's say, of both governments and international experts, independent experts, which is the case of IBC and COMEST. And so the issues that are discussed at the national level can be brought to the global level. And at the same time, the global reflection can be then brought back home. You see, so we see this like a double way that it should be. And also the possibility, since some of the reports and some of the recommendations are being shaped there, or some normative documents, to have included the perspective of the national bioethics committees in the making of these documents. And the real last thing I want to say is, for example, now the IBC is going to develop the two new reports, one on benefit sharing and one of human rights and human genome. And we're changing a little bit the way they are going to develop these reports and seeking for inputs on the very early stage of the development of these reports, asking for governments. Probably some of you will get already, because we are distributing already a very very basic concept note, and we are seeking for some guidance or some opinion of national bioethics committees and different and the constituencies in government, the relevant ones, on what could be important for policy making. So these reports will be really targeted and focused and could address the possible gaps that are existing at the national level.
Thank you very much. That seemed to be some fruitful points to start from, to do more networking between these levels of work. So thank you to everyone here in front. for the concise answers. And now the floor is open and you can put your questions. We have just 17 minutes left till the next session. So please go ahead. Who wants to make a remark or ask a question?
I'm representing Siam, so I have Switzerland on my card, but of course in reality I'm Dutch. And you know the Dutch, they're always straightforward and they're not really politically very wise, so maybe I am saying the wrong thing here. But from what I heard you saying, could that imply that in 10 years from now, the Global Forum is really the international forum to provide guidance to governments in ethical issues? And that maybe sort of, because we now have, we have commissions within the UN bodies, right? And the Global Forum does not have that really very firm mandate from a UN body. And from what you said, could the Global Forum develop into something that could really provide ethical guidance to governments, to a think tank? Yeah, I'm looking at Daphne, but certainly you're not the only one who's. But this was something that sort of emerged from what you were saying by involving the National Ethics Committees into the work of the IBC. There already is a sort of a mix going on between the perspectives, and well, you actually wonder whether this Global Forum could maybe even become stronger in providing guidance, more than just exchanging experiences, which is what Christiane said at the beginning. Yeah.
Well, what I meant is because Christiane asked me what the Global Summit could be, so if the Global Summit is addressing, I don't think, I mean, the idea of bringing the national committees to the Global Bioethics, Ethics, Science and Technology Forum at UNESCO, you know, that's one thing. That's one forum, one global forum with the governments, with the relevant global bodies, making that reflection. In that sense, that was the interaction. And there it could be direct interaction between the governing bodies of UNESCO that at someday that could reach even the General Conference. Now, I think the Global Summit, as I see it, the Global Summit is always a place of exchange of views and opportunities to advance in reflections that then can be brought to this other global level, if you want, the super global, if you want. I mean, the idea there is to have direct contact interaction with them. And here, so it was like saying, what are the challenges? I said, what are the challenges that we identified? If they are reflected here, then probably some of the things will be brought back there. But I don't really think I meant that this should be like a body that it's making recommendations.
What an interesting discussion, which also illustrates the wealth of different structures that we have in place that we can even like attain like several levels of confusion with regard to what exactly we're talking about. But I wouldn't want to leave the colleagues on this impression. There is already intense collaboration between the different international organizations that are sitting on this panel. And there is also reflection, and it would be terrific if either in the few minutes that are left now in this session or you know, also in the corridors, we could gain a greater insight on how to optimize these aspects. There are indeed different occasions throughout the year in which different national ethics councils or commissions are brought together. This raises a number of issues. Let me just highlight two for our consideration. One is to ensure that there's no duplication and that there is optimal synergies between those different configurations. And the other issue is what happens to, I heard we were representing 50 national committees in this esteemed gathering. What happens to the others? What happens to those who do not come to this, who do not come to the, you know, the various summits and forums that were mentioned, and I could add in the international dialogue that the European Commission is convening. We have the pleasure and privilege of inviting a number of national ethics councils, but there are many more that we do not see. And so in our reflection on the benefits that can be derived from our coming together in terms of exchange of information, in terms of joint endeavors, in terms of mutual learning, in terms of capacity building, let's also have a moment, have a thought for those who are not with us in this room, and let's think maybe in the minutes that are left or surely in the days to come as to how they can also usefully be invited. And a last point, these question marks that I provide to your consideration are those that we are hard at work probing the colleagues who are on this side of the table. So there is already this reflection on how we can better work together and on how we can ensure that the colleagues that are not represented can be involved in different ways. Daphne already made some comments to that effect a moment ago.
Thank you very much. Now I have Alastair Campbell.
Well, I'm representing Singapore, but like my Dutch friend, I tend to speak bluntly as a Scotsman. So I think it's great to hear the way that the different organizations are talking to each other and collaborating. Let me give you a view from the region as opposed to the international view. So it can be quite confusing. WHO and UNESCO each have regional offices. In addition to that, the EU has an office in Singapore, but it was very obvious very early on that all they're interested in is trade, money, but not in ethics. And yet we were a partner in an EU, in an EC grant, as an Asian partner. Then Singapore is a small country. There, you know, there are, counting the expats, there are about 5 million people. So the bioethics community is relatively small, and it's great to have, we have people on the two UNESCO committees, both the governmental one and the IBC. We've also, of course, got people coming to the Congress, people coming here, and so on. But I hope that the various organizations will look at regional as well as international collaborations and looking at priorities in relation to bioethics in the region. I'm speaking from a particular regional perspective here, but I think that would be felt elsewhere as well. So it's just great to hear this, and please work at it and work at it on the ground as well as at this slightly elevated level of an international meeting.
Thank you so much for strengthening this. Now it's Joachim Vetter from the German Ethics Council, the General Secretary.
Thank you. I have a question primarily to Hans van Delden and Siams, but also to the others. We have heard about converging technologies, and there's also one word around everywhere, it's big data. Is big data and health technologies something that's as challenge on the agenda of Siams, but also of the other organizations?
Yes, it is. But it's fair to say that the priming attention now is on biomedical research, because we are revising the biomedical research guidelines. And you cannot put everything into one guideline. I think I'm quoting you now, who said something to that effect, that if you put everything into one guideline, you actually get a mixture that is not very helpful. So yes, it's there on the list to be dealt with, but for right now, no. I would say that will not be a major item in the biomedical guidelines.
Laurence?
Thank you. I mean, those two items are what I would call transversal issues in the Council of Europe. And at the moment, in bioethics, as you know, we are starting working on emerging technologies. And I would say the concerns about privacy linked to the massive productions of health-related data, their processing and storage, would certainly be a key issue. And that will be addressed at the conference next year. Independently of that, the data protection sector in the Council of Europe is also working on those issues from their perspective of really data protections. But we have now, we are planning joint activity. So it's not like a one activity focusing on this, but it's more a transversal issue that is addressed from different perspectives. And the idea of that conference next year is to set some kind of agenda, but not necessarily only for the Council of Europe, by the way, but within the Council of Europe, possibly also by different bodies. I think those are issues that are difficult to address in one single eye. I tend to agree with Hans on this, that it's difficult to have one guidelines, but it's extremely important to look at the different aspects of it. And this is clearly one, to me, if I had to ask what are the biggest challenges, I think that's management of health-related data is certainly a huge challenge.
Yeah, just in relation to the guidance on new technologies and big data, especially in relation to big data, I think WHO is very, very much, in a way, concerned about developing guidance in the use, storage, management, sharing of big data. It's a huge issue. It's with us. It's not that it's tomorrow. It's there. And we are in the process of developing guidance for, especially, say, in the area of electronic medical and health records, but also in relation to combining big databases, having all different types of information in them, which could be potentially, which can be very, very helpful to solve some of the big issues that we have, but also could be potentially risky to the individuals. The good thing for us in currently in WHO, the place where we are sitting, the ethics section is sitting, is under the department of Dr. Najib Al-Shorbaji, who's actually the person who's really interested in all these issues. He has his experience and expertise in this. So it's extremely helpful because we know it'll get a push. We have a full unit on e-health. So we know that the two units can work together and bring something. Having said that, it's not, and as you said, Laurence, it's not that one unit is doing. And within WHO, different departments are also working in different ways and developing guidance. So we developed guidance for dual-use technology, which is part of the new technologies being used for different, for ways that they were not designed to be used but could be harmful to or risky to humanity. But we also have other departments working on how to deal with issues related to data management. And so there is a lot of work going on. It is on our, it's on our agenda, and we will be working on it. We're also working in relation to surveillance, for example, and the use of data in surveillance technology.
So we have now. Yeah, Daphne, you want to comment as well? Yeah, then we have two other contributions, then we have to come to an end, unfortunately.
Because for UNESCO agenda, well, again, I think for the next 2 years, basically, in relation to data, it will be more related to genetics, because they are going to work more on genetics and human rights and potentially in converging technology. So all these issues probably will be addressed, but in those terms. And I also wanted to relate to the comment on the regional issue. I appreciate very much the last comment from Singapore, because I think it helps us as well, because we are really struggling in achieving more collaboration, more coordination. And this forum is not only good so you'll know what we do, but also for us to know how better work with you and for you. You have to know that there is the UN Interagency Committee on Bioethics. So we try at that level also, and all of us at this table are also part of this committee. And so this will inform also our meetings, where so we will discuss this back home. Thanks.
Jin?
Yeah, indeed. So on indeed the Singaporean perspective. As Daphne, I really welcome these inputs, and hopefully we can hear more, you know, in the course of our interactions in the coming days. The idea is indeed to hear you, to discuss with you, to have proper conversations so that these things can be improved. And you know, the sort of caveat that Laurence you know, indicated with regard to the Council of Europe also applies to the European Commission, although in a different way. We're by essence a very regional organization. At the same time, the EU is, you know, represented throughout the world through its External Action Service. And in actual fact, this representation in Mexico, not everyone maybe is interested in ethics, but the colleague will be here tomorrow with us because he's taking a particular interest, the head of representation in Mexico. Everything is possible. Now, specifically on big data and health technologies, Joachim's question. Very, very topical also from the European Commission perspective. We have, as I'm sure many of you know, the clinical trials regulatory framework that has been finalized. We're in the process of revising the regulatory framework on data protection and privacy. This is, of course, a very important one. And then, as I was indicating briefly, we've just completed this important report, this opinion of the European Group on Ethics, on the ethics of security and surveillance technologies. Read big data, and not only state surveillance, but also from corporate actors. And the new opinion that I was talking about, which is on the involvement of public and different stakeholders in the production of knowledge and innovation in the health domain, is also very much about big data in the health area. So absolutely, very, very topical for us as well.
Manuel, you wanted to say something?
Yes, I'm very happy with this panel and the presentations about what the international organizations are doing. And I would like to see now, perhaps we could think in a strategic plan for the next 2 years. I think that the time is short, we have the information, and we are able to set up a strategic plan in order to get priorities and then to work on it. Otherwise, it will be difficult to bring out. But something which is, I'm thinking all the time, that we think in terms, for example, from the global approach, but I think that we think we have to bring bioethics near to the people, because we think in terms in policy and so on, but most of the people, the society, they don't know what it is about bioethics. And we have to make a big deal in order to diffuse, to promote the knowledge of bioethics and the benefits that society, the individual, have from bioethics. Thank you.
So, Laurence?
Yeah. Well, I just wanted to maybe complement what I said at the beginning, but coming back to your initial question about universality, because I think that ethical issues are common issues for a long time in many countries. But I think that the reality in the field also making things even more global in a practical terms, exchanging data, exchanging samples. That's one of the examples where we see a more globalization of those issues also. So for me, the opportunity to exchange outside the regional level is also certainly very important because, again, those issues can certainly be discussed at a regional level, but I think the real dimension of the problems is larger. And even though at a regional level, at the level of government, they may agree on a certain number of principles, I think all the discussion at the global level is actually providing food for thought also and contributing to the general reflection. So these global summits provide an opportunity for that. I think the papers which were drafted are quite useful in that respect to continue, would say, using that as a basis for reflection, contributing to that. But I just wanted to take that opportunity to also thank the organizer and Mexican authorities and Manuel and his team for these organizations. But I also wanted to use Mexico as an example of universal value of rights and cultural differences, because if I understand well, we might have soon Mexico joining the group of country having ratified the Oviedo Convention. And Mexico would be, in that case, the first non-European country to do that. So I think it's right. A practical example of answering part of your question you raised initially. So I just wanted to add that as an element of answer to your initial question. Thank you.
That's a great information. Thank you so much. So now I have the task to end the session, unfortunately. I was very happy with the discussion. I think we all feel that we have shared issues that we deal with, that we want to make this world better from the perspective of bioethics and what bioethics can contribute to that, that we have a long way before us, that we already went some of this way, some part, but not enough. So we have a lot to do, and so I can play the ball to you for the next session where the Global Summit can reflect on that according to the questions you already yesterday had in the regional conferences. Let me just add a personal statement and some personal aspects, because you know that Germany was the National Ethics Committee that applied to host the next summit, so I would have liked to introduce that to you in the next session. And thank you so much to all of you. Thank you, Manuel, for having me here, for having us here, and have all very much, very good discussions today and for the World Congress as well. Thank you very much, and goodbye, perhaps in Berlin, hopefully.